So the title of my talk today is Neural Correlates of Consciousness in the Prefrontal Cortex, in particular in the non-human primate prefrontal cortex. Okay, so just a quick summary about what we mean when we talk about consciousness. I guess this has already been said in this conference, but maybe it's useful to summarize this again. Consciousness can be discriminated between contents and levels. For example, under normal levels of consciousness, like in wakefulness, it is possible to have conscious experience. For example, when we walk in a park and we see in front of us a dog, there are neurons in different cortical areas in the brain, and in this case we have normal information transmission and processing that allows sensory awareness. And these neurons that are activated for specific stimuli, like the dog, these are supposed to constitute the neural correlates of consciousness. Now, apart from the contents of consciousness, we also have the levels of consciousness, as many people said before. So in this case, when we have impaired levels of consciousness, like under general anesthesia, which can be considered like a situation like a drug-induced coma, a disorder of consciousness, in this case we have disruption of conscious experience. And so in this case, although it is possible to have sensory input, like auditory or visual input, it is not possible to have sensory awareness. So we have a condition where there is sensory unawareness and the neural correlates of consciousness are diminished. So in general, the goal of my research is to identify the cortical network that mediates conscious perception. But also study more recently the mechanisms that disrupt this network during anesthesia and also use anesthesia as a model for disorders of consciousness. Okay, so from a theoretical perspective, as many of you know, we have global neuronal workspace. So this is a theory that was developed to suggest that there is a cortical network that mediates conscious perception. And actually what happens is that there are many individual processors in the brain that can process information unconsciously, but then at some point there's a specific event that is happening, which is, it can be ignition, and in this case there is activation that is widespread across the brain. So in this case what is actually experienced is this broad activation across many different cortical areas. More recently, this has, of course, this is experimental evidence, but also from a theoretical point of view, it was recently shown that the areas that are predicted from the GNW to be part of this cortical workspace, they are characterized through graph theoretical measures from high information processing capacity, and they can be described by this bow tie architecture. So we have all these areas that are in the center of this architecture, and they are like prefrontal, frontal, temporal, and parietal areas, but prefrontal cortex is definitely a part of this network that is characterized by very high information transmission capacity. Of course, there is a very long debate about the role of the prefrontal cortex. And I will just like very briefly review the first experimental evidence showing the activation of prefrontal cortex during conscious processing using fMRI report paradigm. So the subjects, they have to detect stimuli and they have to report about them. So like we have to understand that in these paradigms, reporting about the conscious content is a critical component of the task. In this paper by Stan in 2001, there were words that were presented embedded within other stimuli that were clearly consciously perceived or that they were visually masked. So although the presentation of the word here is the same, the time of presentation, in this case the word is masked. And the result was that with fMRI, the result was that when the words were invisible, the activation in the cortex remained very, very local. And it was mostly localized in the visual word form area. But then, under the condition that the word was consciously perceived, a very broad network was activated in the brain that included frontal and parietal areas. And a very characteristic pattern in this case is this ignition. So even in the visual word form area, the activation was much more pronounced, and it was characterized by this non-linear activation. So this is a signature of ignition. There were other papers showing more or less the same pattern. For example, this paper by Sadagiani, where the subjects had to detect auditory stimuli that were near threshold. And when these stimuli were detected, again, a broad frontoparietal network was activated. But when the sound was not detected, the activation remained very local in the auditory cortex. So this is experimental evidence showing this activation of the frontoparietal network that mediates conscious perception. Of course, as I said, these are report paradigms, so there is this critique that maybe what we see there is not really the cortical processing about the contents, or the real contents of consciousness, but mostly about reporting about them. And of course, this has led to other approaches. For example, the integrated information theory suggests that what actually mediates conscious perception is not prefrontal cortex, but the posterior cortex, posterior cortical hot zone that includes the parietal and the occipital lobe. One piece of evidence that was used to support this idea, or that is used to support this idea, is this paper involving binocular rivalry. So binocular rivalry is a paradigm of multistable perception where we present two different stimuli in each of the eyes. And then what happens is actually something very interesting. Although stimulation remains constant, we start having spontaneous fluctuation in conscious experience. So we present either one or the other stimulus. So one of the stimuli is consciously perceived for a given time, and then perception switches to the other stimulus, so therefore this stimulus becomes suppressed, and so on and so forth. Now, what is interesting is that if we present binocular rivalry using opposing direction of motions, for example, if we present an upward moving grating in the left eye and a downward moving grating in the right eye, it is not necessary to have a report. So it is possible to use the eye movements, and specifically the optokinetic nystagmus, to infer what is consciously perceived from the subject. For example, we know that if a leftward motion direction is perceived, we have this very specific eye movement pattern, while if the rightward motion is perceived, we have a very different eye movement pattern. So it is possible from the eye movement patterns to infer what is consciously perceived. And what is important is that this is not a voluntary eye movement. So this is a reflexive eye movement pattern. So when in this study, subjects were asked to report their percept through button presses, it was found that again a large cortical network was activated that included prefrontal cortex but also parietal cortex. So in this case, the subjects had to report. But then what happened is that when the subjects were asked not to report and perception was inferred just from the eye movements, exactly the same subjects and exactly the same brains, the prefrontal cortex was suppressed. So this was used as a piece of evidence suggesting that no report binocular rivalry suggests that posterior cortical areas mediate conscious experience, and prefrontal cortex mediates only the consequences of conscious experience and post-perceptual processing. Now, what is interesting in this binocular rivalry stimulation paradigm, but also in general in multistable stimuli, is that it is possible to have a dissociation of subjective perception of conscious contents from sensory stimulation. For example, another paradigm is this famous duck rabbit illusion. So if you see the stimulus for some time, you will realize that you can perceive either a duck or a rabbit. And most of the times, you cannot really consciously perceive both of them simultaneously. So you have this, again, this spontaneous fluctuation in conscious perception. Binocular rival is a much better paradigm from one point of view, because you can you have much clearer, much more clear transitions. And the way that we induce binocular rival is through a stereoscope. So this is a very preliminary design of stereoscope from the 19th century. So the stereoscope is like a mirror. So we have two mirrors, and through each one of these mirrors, we can stimulate one eye with a different stimulus. For example, the right eye can see let's say, a face here, while the left eye can be stimulated with another stimulus that is presented here. And so what is interesting from this point of view is that if we combine this stimuli with intracortical recordings, it is theoretically possible to record from neurons that code for its stimulus during the perceptual dominance and suppression of the preferred stimulus of each neuron. So some years ago, we used the modification of binocular rivalry, that is using externally induced perceptual switches. And we recorded from the inferior convexity of the prefrontal cortex in the macaque monkey, which is the homologue of the prefrontal areas that were shown to be non-activated during no-report binocular rivalry. So we used the twisted wire tetrodes that allow excellent single unit isolation, as you can see here. And the way that we performed these experiments is we were recording activity of single units, and we didn't ask the monkeys to report. So for example, for 1 second, we presented we stimulated the left eye of the macaque with a geometric pattern, this polar checkerboard that you can see here. And after 1 second, we left the first stimulus there, and we stimulated the right eye with a phase stimulus. What happens in this case is that the first stimulus is perceptually suppressed, and what is consciously perceived is the phase stimulus. And this is like an interesting situation because you have two stimuli that stimulate actually the visual system, but only one of them is consciously perceived. So we recorded from neurons in this area of the prefrontal cortex, and this is like one example unit with activation of this unit across many trials. And this is a phase selective neuron, so you can see that when the visual system is when we have stimulation with the checkerboard, there is no activation, but then this neuron fires very strongly for the phase stimulus. And then what we do is we reverse the order. So we present the phase stimulus first, and then we suppress this phase stimulus by presenting the other stimulus, which is the checkerboard. And what happens in this case is that although the neuron fires very strongly for the phase stimulus at the beginning, you can see that as soon as the phase stimulus, the perception of the phase stimulus is suppressed, we have this rather transient suppression of neural activity, and then the neuron actually continues to fire, but it doesn't fire as much as it used to fire for the phase stimulus, although the phase stimulus is there. This is very important. So we recorded many neurons in this area, and the general pattern that that we had is that most of the neurons actually fired more when their preferred stimulus was perceived, and this is what you see, for example, in this plot. So here we plot the sensory selectivity of all the neurons that we recorded. So each point here is a neuron; it's the D prime of one neuron, and this is the sensory selectivity of the neuron versus the perceptual selectivity. And what is interesting to see is that most of the neurons fall within this area, which means that all the neurons during this ambiguous stimulation paradigm, they maintain their selectivity. So they continue to fire more when the preferred stimulus is perceived, and they suppress their firing when the preferred stimulus is perceptually suppressed, but it's still present. So what is interesting is that although this is a no-report paradigm, we also find, apart from representations of conscious contents in the prefrontal cortex, we also find activity that is related to task phase. So again, the monkey doesn't have to perform any report. He just passively views the stimuli, but we can see we can still have neurons that looks that they encode for different times, for different phases of the experiment. For example, you can see different paradigms of neurons here, the activity of single units, and you can see that for each one of the single units, the activity peaks at a different time point during the task, which is, again, it's a no-report task. So when we plot the peak, when we sort the neurons depending on the peak of their activity, we find the sequential activity patterns. But when we perform a factorization analysis using non-negative matrix factorization, we can actually assign groups of neurons to different canonical response patterns, and you see that what we have is that activity actually is peaking at different time points that spans the whole duration of the trial. So this is, again, this is not related to any stimulus preference, so it's whatever the stimulus, we still have the same pattern of activity, and these neurons are separate from the neurons that code for the conscious contents, and they are even functionally segregated, as you can see here. So So this is these are the correlations between pairs of neurons that prefer, one of them prefers a specific stimulus and the other one prefers a specific temporal pattern. And you can see that the correlations, the noise correlations, so the trial by trial fluctuation in the activity of these neurons, it's much reduced compared to neurons that come from the same, let's say, pool of neurons, like either task phase or content specific activity. And so it looks like at least for this paradigm, we have a parallel representation of these two features of activity. So we have task phase units. And we also have conscious content units. And it looks like, at least taking into account the noise correlations, these neurons are functionally disconnected, or at least functionally less connected than neurons that, that are coming from the same pool. So more recently, we started, we tried to push more into recording from prefrontal and parietal areas in the macaque brain, and we started using UTA arrays. So multi-electrode recordings, and the advantage of the multi-electrode recordings is, of course, you know that we can have this mesoscale monitoring of activity because these are really small chips, 4x4 millimeters. And apart from that, it's very important that because we can record from many neurons simultaneously, we can examine multivariate. We can apply multivariate decoding methods. For detecting patterns of neural activity that are predictive of conscious experience at a single trial level. So this is just a movie, I will not show this, but this is just how many neurons we can get with this array. So this is just a prefrontal array, and this is a parietal array, and you can see that we have many units from even in the same electrode. Sometimes we can record 2 or 3 units from the same electrode. So what we did, so I will just show you results for now from the prefrontal cortex. So what we did is that we repeated more or less the same experiment that was done in humans using fMRI. We repeated the same experiment in macaque monkeys using electrophysiology. So we used the no-report binocular rivalry of opposing motion direction. And the structure of the task, as you can see here, is that we have a physical alternation control trial where we just physically exchange the stimulus in each one of these eyes. So we stimulate the left eye with upward motion. After a while, we switch to downward motion in the right eye, and so on and so forth for around 8 to 10 seconds. And the monkey just has to passively fixate and receives reward at the end. And during all this time, we also monitor the eye movements. And in the binocular rivalry trial, what we do is we start, let's say, with an upward motion in the left eye. We leave the stimulus there for the whole duration of the trial, but then after 1 or 2 seconds, we stimulate the right eye with an opposing motion, a stimulus of motion direction, so here with a downward motion. What happens in this case is that we have a flash suppression period, so as soon as this stimulus is presented, it results in the perceptual suppression of the first stimulus. And after a while, what is even more interesting is that if you leave the stimuli there, they start to rival. So you start having the spontaneous alternations of conscious perception. And at the same time, we record activity with the multi-electrode arrays. So here, these are some data showing the eye movement patterns in like many trials. And for example, as you can see here, we start with with this pattern of OKN, then there is this flash suppression period, and you can see that the polarity of the signal, of the eye movement signal changes. And then after a while, we start having spontaneous transitions, moving from one to the other stimulus. So we recorded activity in the PFC, and these are some example neurons that you can see. So this is again a physical alternation trial, so no rivalry. And you can see that we have simultaneously recorded neurons that prefer either one or the other stimulus, so either upward or downward moving direction. For example, this neuron prefers downward moving direction. You see that it fires a lot here, it stops firing, it fires back again, while these other neurons prefer more the opposing motion direction. Now, of course, what is the question is what is happening during binocular rivalry, where we have this competitive visual stimulation. And what we find is that these neurons continue to fire in the same way as they fire in binocular rivalry. So these are the same neurons that you can see here, and the pattern more or less is the same. So they continue to fire more when their preferred stimulus is perceived and suppress their firing when the preferred stimulus is suppressed. What is interesting is that we find a very nice structure using the UTA array. So when we project the activity of the neurons back into the spatial map that we have from the UTA array, we find that we have these zones where neurons with groups of neurons that prefer either one or the other direction of motion. For example, here these pixels represent spiking activity or units that prefer downward motion, while the pink pixels reflect neurons that prefer more the upward motion. Again, as in the flash suppression condition, we find that most of the units, the very large majority of the units, continues to fire more when the preferred stimulus is perceived. And there is only a very small representation of non-conscious contents, which are these units here. And of course, this becomes even stronger when the when we look at neurons that have a very high selectivity, at they have a very high D prime. Okay, so of course, until now, what I showed is analysis at the single unit level, but we can just pull all the neuronal activity together, and we can apply, as I said previously, multivariate decoding analysis, and see if at a single trial level we can have decoding of the conscious content from the population of recorded neurons. So here you can see the patterns, the population trajectory of the competing populations that we can simultaneously record in physical alternation and also in binocular rivalry. And zero is the time where we observe a change in the eye movement pattern. So this is the time when conscious contents flip from one interpretation to the other. And what you can see is that we have this very nice crossover of the population trajectories that indicates neurons that either increase or decrease their firing rate depending on what is, if their preferred stimulus is perceived or not. And we can also apply this cross-temporal generalization, and we can find that we can generalize between physical alternation and binocular rivalry, which is very important because it indicates that the same neurons that are modulated during non-binocular rivalry condition, they continue to fire for their preferred pattern during binocular rivalry. Now, what is interesting is, of course, these results show us that we have very clear modulation of prefrontal activity during binocular rivalry, and neural populations really reflect the conscious contents. But something else that we try to see in this data is if we have some kind of signal that can actually predict, or if there is something in the signal that precedes the spontaneous change, so something like a predictive signal. And when we look at the LFPs, what we find is something very interesting is that, so these are the spontaneous switches during binocular rivalry, and this is like one eye movement pattern where you see the switch from one to the other stimulus, the spontaneous switch. And what is interesting here is that you can see is that just before the switch, we have an activation of low frequency activity, which is accompanied by a suppression of beta band activity. And after the switch happens, we have a return to the normal state. So this is just the Hilbert transform of the LFP signal in different bands, in the beta band and the low frequency band. And you can see that you have this, we see these very strong fluctuations just before the switch during binocular rivalry.
So when we actually trigger the activity, when we trigger the spectrograms at this low frequency activity peaks, we have something very clear, which is that whenever we have this low frequency activity increase, there is a suppression in the beta band. So it looks like there is there's a change in the cortical state just before the switch in binocular rivalry that precedes both the change in the eye movements, but also the change in the population trajectories. So it looks like this is a separate signal. Now, what is interesting is that this signal shows a very characteristic signature, which we interpret this as a spatial ignition-like spread of low-frequency activity. Maybe I will just go quickly over this, but what you see here is the number of channels. So this is the UTA array, and this is the number of channels
that show very strong low frequency activity as we approach a perceptual switch. And you can see that during the early period there are not so many, middle period also not so many, and then just before the switch, which is like around 200 to 300 milliseconds before a switch in conscious content, we see that the large majority of the electrodes is actually activated. So we see that it's like a special special ignition, like a burst that is observed across a large area of the prefrontal cortex that we can record with the UTARI. And these are just four examples where you can see that this pattern is repeated.
Okay, so so now there is still a discussion. So although these results are coming from no report studies, there is still a discussion if even in these results we have post-perceptual processing. So this was actually highlighted in this opinion paper by the philosopher Ned Block, and the idea is that even in cases where we don't, where subjects are not really asked to report what they perceive, they can still think about the stimulus. For example, when during binocular rivalry, when an upward motion is perceived, maybe the monkeys are bored and they think, ah, this is an upward moving grating, and the other way around. And then at the end, maybe the activity that we see is not really related to, let's say, pure consciousness, but just to some kind of post-perceptual processing or thinking. I mean, what is interesting is that from this point of view, this idea is coming more from the point of view that consciousness should be more related to phenomenal consciousness, which, as Peter said before, it's related to iconic memory versus access consciousness that involves the selection of a specific stimulus. So we tried to address this problem using by developing a new paradigm of visual stimulation, of RSVP, rapid serial visual presentation stimulation. And the task structure is like this. So what we try to do is to eliminate post-perceptual processing. And the way that we try to do this is by rapidly presenting visual stimuli so that there is not enough time for the subjects to think about this stimuli. So for example, we presented stimuli for very briefly, for 17 milliseconds, either isolated or embedded within a rapid serial visual presentation. So the idea for this task is that we want to eliminate post-perceptual processing of stimuli. So what we do is we just present very fast the stimuli. And what we find is that even under these conditions that actually challenge post-perceptual processing, what you can see here is that all the stimuli that are presented can be decoded with very high accuracy from the activity of populations in the prefrontal cortex. So these are all the stimuli that we presented, and the black curve represents the decoding of the stimuli when they are presented in isolation, and the blue line, the same stimuli when they are presented in RSVP. What is interesting is that although the peak of the activity is more or less the same for most of the stimuli, what is really missing in RSVP is this late component of activity after around 200 milliseconds. So this is in general the summary of the patterns that we get. So we can also apply temporal generalization matrices decoding, and you can see that the code remains there, although it is like temporally compressed. And here is the average decoder accuracy for stimuli that are presented either in isolation or this is the last stimulus. So you can see that in this case we have a peak at the decoding accuracy at around 120 milliseconds, but decoding starts becoming significant much, much earlier. And we have also the sustained part of the activity. But then during RSVP, although the peak activity is there, what is really missing is this late component of activity. So we can decode stimuli, these stimuli from both prefrontal and parietal cortex activity. This is just one example from one monkey. And this is the average decoding accuracy for the prefrontal cortex and the parietal cortex. You see that prefrontal cortex it looks like it's much stronger. Maybe it has to do with the number of electrodes that are activated, although we try to balance for this. But I mean, the important thing is that from these two areas of the global neuronal workspace that are hypothesized to reflect conscious content, we can really decode this stimuli.
So I will just try to move fast here. So like, I also want to say a few things about some experiments that we are doing recently to study the prefrontal cortex states and responsiveness under anesthesia. So there was this recent paper out, that came out from Neurospin from the group of Basir Jaraya that showed that during anesthesia, when they stimulated the thalamus with deep brain stimulation, what they found is that a whole brain network was activated using fMRI. So you can see that frontal, parietal, and also other areas were activated. And this stimulation, this deep brain stimulation, also induced arousal. But very importantly, it activated the prefrontal cortex. So what we wanted to do is we wanted to really zoom in the prefrontal cortex and record during anesthesia, but also record after electrical stimulation. And we want to do this to study mesoscale responsiveness, which is like a critical component to bridge scales. And it's also probably very much related to what Marcello is going to talk about later. But also we have a long-term goal to induce through electrical microstimulation awake-like cortical states. So this is the work of Abilas Dwarakanath. So we focus again on the frontoparietal network, but now I will just talk about the frontal cortex. So the protocol of our experiment is as follows. So we start with recordings during wakefulness, a resting state during wakefulness. We induce anesthesia with a single injection of ketamine. We intubate the animal. We start with light sevoflurane. We maintain anesthesia for a period. We switch to deep sevoflurane, and then we switch to another anesthetic, light and deep propofol. So during all these times, between the different changes in the anesthetics, we also stimulate either the center or the whole array. And then we stimulate and record for 20 seconds. But we also have resting state activity before and after its stimulation. So we can see how activity is actually, the patterns of activity that are induced by the different anesthetics, but also if we can really recover awake patterns following electrical stimulation. So this is, these are the results when we stimulate the center of the array. So what you see here is the evoked responses following microstimulation during conscious wakefulness. You see that the evoked responses, here we sort them as a function of distance from the center of the array. You can see that we have strong evoked responses, but these evoked responses are severely disrupted during both sevoflurane and propofol. What we are also measuring is the amplitude of the LFP signal as a function of distance from the center of the array. And what you see is that during the awake state, activity actually propagates. So this is the L2 norm modulation of the local field potential as a function of distance from the center of stimulation. So activity can propagate laterally. While under the different types of anesthetics, we have a severe disruption of this lateral propagation. So under light sevoflurane, it looks like we still have some propagation, but then this activity dies, is suppressed very fast. While under deep sevoflurane and propofol, we have a very diminished propagation of activity. So these are some preliminary results. We also try to compute perturbation complexity index at the mesoscale. And these are the results with 15 microamps stimulation under wakefulness. So you can see that we have a high perturbation complexity index during the awake state, but PCI becomes very much reduced during the different types of anesthetics. And then, one more minute, okay. So again, this is very preliminary, but we are very excited about these results. So I would like also to have your feedback about this. So what you see here is, so this is the spiking activity coming from many channels of the UTA array. And overlaid on this is the average local field potential. So this is the activity that we observe during resting wakefulness. This is the activity during light sevoflurane anesthesia. And this is the activity during light sevoflurane anesthesia, but after electrical stimulation of the prefrontal cortex. And I hope, yeah, the movie of course doesn't play. So, but I think it's clear. You know, you can see that we have a recovery of an awake cortical state even during light sevoflurane anesthesia after electrical microstimulation. So this is under deep sevoflurane. I mean, something that is not really possible to see is that this is actually the effect of the previous stimulation. So we start having a desynchronized activity, but then as we move on and the deep sevoflurane effects start to kick in, we start having again this very clear up and down states that characterize anesthesia. But what is interesting is that after stimulation, electrical stimulation of the array, we cannot really recover awake cortical states. So it looks like there is a gradient. It looks like it's relatively easy to recover awake cortical states under light anesthesia or light sedation, but not when we move in a regime where we have much stronger anesthesia. And the same is observed under light propofol. So again, compared to resting wakefulness, we have the synchronized activity, up and down states during light propofol anesthesia and recovery of these desynchronized states after the electrical stimulation of the prefrontal cortex. And again, we cannot really observe this phenomenon during deep propofol anesthesia. Okay, so conclusions. So what we find is that prefrontal cortex populations reflect conscious contents even without subjective reports in all these no-report paradigms. We can find, even during no-report, parallel processing of conscious contents and task phase in the prefrontal cortex. We have a very early decoding of visual images in the PFC under conditions that challenge post-perceptual processing. So we believe that what we see in the PFC is not related to post-perceptual processing, even under no report. And this may suggest a role for prefrontal cortex in phenomenal consciousness, if we agree in this distinction between phenomenal and access consciousness. There is a propagation of intracranial electric stimulation effects during the awake state, and also the mesoscale PCI is quite high in the awake state, but both the propagation of the effects and the mesoscale PCI are suppressed during anesthesia. However, what is interesting is that under light anesthesia, the electrical microstimulation that we apply looks like it can elicit awake-like activity patterns, in this case, desynchronized activity, which we hope and we think we are going to work on this to use it as a new or a complementary probe for evaluating disorders of consciousness. So thank you very much, and also thanks to all these people who participated in this research.